We're on.
Oh, well, there's nothing like it. Now, people say to me, Bruce, what were the best days of your life? Musically, the best days of my life were playing with Noel Brisbane here, Gary Moore, and the greatest skid row of all time. We were only a three-piece, and Billy McPhillow and Bernard Chivas was in the original band. But it was really Gary, Noel, and myself.
When we had hair.
Well, people say to me, no, what do you miss most? Yeah, what do you miss most about the band? Hair is what I miss now. But this is Noel here, and he's the main man. So, Noel, we met long before we were musicians. Is that right?
That's right, Brennan. You were, at the time, you were Kurt and Mara next door. She was my next door neighbour. So I was saying, how can I impress this bloke so we can get together?
Yeah.
So I used to leave the window open. That's remember, right. I played the accordion.
That's right. I remember it well, though.
And then I played the clarinet, do you remember?
Yeah.
Ackerville.
I couldn't believe it, though.
And Stranger on the Shore.
I remember it distinctly. Coming up to the Fisbury Road, you're living in the one room.
But anyway, you got the message.
You know. And then, what happened after that, now?
Oh Lord, God, I used to go around and see you playing with the Uptown Band,
yeah,
with Mojo,
yes.
Desi Reynolds.
That's right.
Desi Reynolds, and was Brenny Bonass there as well?
Brenny Bonass, and yourself. Mojo.
Mojo?
Yeah.
Mojo, the wild man of the organ.
That's right.
That's when we used to stab it to death with knives.
Emerson, Lake and Palmer, he had his own knife though.
Yeah. And Desi was a phenomenal drummer, fantastic. I went and got a few lessons off Desi, trying to pick his brains, how to learn how to play like he did.
Yeah.
It was great. And then we just got together, really, basically. Myself, Bernard Chambers.
That's right. And Philip. And Ted and myself, we got it going, you came down, then Bernard came down, then we auditioned Philip.
That's right.
Yeah, brought him up for an audition, and it was, hey Joe, and Benny Sheba says to me, called me up, says, I think I can sing it better. You know, we've done the hey Joe. That was that.
No, Philip was very shy then, Brad, very shy.
Yeah.
But yeah, they were fantastic, and then, I remember doing a gig up in the, the Adelaide Road.
Yeah.
What was it called? The Adelaide Hall.
There's a name for the hall, but I can't remember.
And we had Ashtar. Do you remember Ashtar? With the lights.
The liquid lights.
First in the country ever to have all these.
We were the first psychedelic.
Psychedelic lights, that's it. Psychedelic.
And funny enough, we played at Liberty Hall the night my dad died.
That's right, yeah.
That's rock and roll, though, but
yeah.
We were the first with the lights. And then we done a gig with Gary, myself and yourself on the television, and unfortunately Phyllis Hall, or Phyllis McCarthy as he's known now, she pumped a balloon up the pillow and he was singing Badly Off Key, playing with the balloon at the
same
time.
That's right, that's right. Oh, so there was war about that, remember?
Well, we let him go at that more or less.
Yeah, but then I don't think we realised that Phyllis had a problem with his throat, his tonsils were.
Yeah.
So I think you persuaded him to go to England for an operation, and get it fixed, and he never looked back after that.
But when he came back up, you know, I basically said to him, I was looking at the news here, but when he was away, the tree was on the green. I mean, one of the, you know, be the Irish cream or the Irish Jimi Hendrix, when he came back.
Yeah, but I think there was a little more to it than that, Brian. Like, I mean, I don't think that's rigged the way it was. Like, I think at that time, you're just seeing a little further down the road than the rest of us did. I think you knew that Philo wanted to do his own thing, really.
Yeah,
you knew that, didn't you? And that the only way to encourage him to do his own thing was to actually get him to fly the coop. So you gave him your guitar.
Yeah, that's right.
You showed him a few things and you sent him on his way. I mean, that was the thing to do. Look what he achieved after that. Yeah. So, I mean, I know now and then you sort of give yourself a bit of a knocking for, and you laugh about saying you fired him, but there was a little more to it.
Well, yes.
You know. Do you know? So. Yeah. Let's just get that straight.
Well, he'd a bit more to learn at the time. I mean, you know, he had to become more of a musician.
He did, and he did.
He did, yeah.
He worked very hard at it.
He did, but at that point, we were ready to move to the next.
Do something else,
He had to do whatever he had to do.
Yeah.
And then, next thing you know, Gary, myself, and yourself, we had a deal with CBS, which turned out to be the worst deal of all time.
That's right, 0.5% between the three of us.
That's right. And it took a day to make the first album, 24 hours to make the second album, and it's only about the third album, but they reckon they never recouped their outlay on it. You know, 4 days to make three albums, we still haven't made the money. So we never got a penny out of CBS.
Yeah. Not even an advance.
Nothing.
And 0.5% between three of us. Yeah. God, we were so young and naive, weren't we?
Yeah, we loved it, but we...
You know, it was fantastic. You know, we were in it for the right reasons. We weren't thinking of our bank balance. It was all about just playing music. And it was... Like, I was talking to a friend of mine there, like Eamon. He comes to Rhymes, and he was just saying, he says, I remember seeing Skid Row, he says, when you started, he says, and I suddenly realised that there was another life out there rather than the life that we lived in Dublin, that there was another whole thing to it.
Yeah.
You know, and for us it was, Brandon. For me, like, it was a great escape.
But well, none of us knew what, to us, America could have been the moon, really, you know, sometimes you're gone to America, we say.
And the thing was, we did get to America. And chances when you got off the plane, you were arrested. You remember that when your passport confiscated? The most wanted, you have the same name as the most wanted man in America.
You're gone to America, we say.
And the thing was, we did get to America. And chances when you got off the plane, you were arrested. You remember that when your passport confiscated? The most wanted, you have the same name as the most wanted man in America. I think he was just setting us up though, wasn't he?
What happened was, no, like, I remember the three of us walked up the stairs and I seen these two guys looking at us, and it was our first time in America. And we done exactly the same things we do. Somebody's looking at you. We say, how's it going, lads? That's how we did. The nose over the two boys. How's it going, lads? Next thing, back of the neck. They must have thought I was sending them up. But that night, no, after we got out, we were there for an hour and a half. They kept me passport and all of me. Where did we arrive? The Whiskey Go-Go, Los Angeles.
Right.
And who turned up?
John Bonham, Robert Plant. And they were very good to us, Brian, right, because we'd no money. Do you remember they took us back to their hotel and they put us, they paid for a room for us to put
that's
us up.
That's right.
And I remember standing in the lift with John Bonham. And actually, Ainsley Dunbar was visiting them at the time. And John Bonham says to me, Jesus, I wish I was half as good as Ainsley on the drums. And I says, hold on a minute, John. I wish I was half as good as you. You know, so that gave him a bit of a smile, you know. So everything was relative. He wanted to be as good as Ainsley. I wanted to be as good as him. But a lovely man, John Bonham.
Yeah.
You know, it's a pity that it all ended up the way it did for him like that. Like, such a phenomenal player who influenced so many people. But a gentleman.
Yeah.
Great guy.
We had a great night.
It was fantastic. I remember that, the sun. And the, you know, the beautiful American girls. And I remember I have great memories of going up to the dressing room after the gig and the black American cop sitting in the chair, you know.
That's right,
yeah. Hey, you guys, you ain't bad. Yeah. Real nice guys. They were great.
Best of all, then, no.
Like, wonderful people.
Yeah, and it was.
And then, I'm sorry I'm talking so fast, but I just have some great memories of like, even that little trip to America about the wonderful people we met. Like, do you remember we were stranded in Phoenix, Arizona,
that's right, yeah,
on the edge of the desert? Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And this guy comes up to us and says, well...
He had a kindergarten.
Yeah. Lovely man. Oh, took us home to his place. Yeah. Swimming pool.
Yeah.
He was an ex-tightrope walker, do you remember?
That's right. And he's wearing a white caftan.
That's right. And he gave us all these lovely robes to wear. Get out of them uncomfortable clothes, he says, and get into these. Oh, fantastic. He put us up for a few days.
Yeah.
I remember opening the fridge door one morning. And I think it was his son said to me, there you go, there's some orange juice if you want that. And I couldn't believe it, because where we come from in Dublin, there's no such thing as orange juice. And he said, you can have as much as you want.
Not that kind of orange juice.
Yeah.
Never seen that like it.
No. It was incredible, the way they treated us, and we hadn't got a juice.
We had no money. We met people every night, though.
I remember I actually shed tears having to leave that house. I did. And you had a great time there in this room, Bill. Remember being elevated?
I love the pool now, love the swimming. But we headed up to Canada that time. And we were topping the bill, Rod Stewart and the Faces. They never turned up. We topped the bill there. Then we played with Beck Bogard and the
Pieces. Do you remember that? Fantastic band too, they were. This wonderful pasture, wasn't it? It was out in big fields.
We never seen that in America.
And it was like a community centre run by hippies, wasn't it? Where they bred their own horses and grew their own food. And life was good then. It was like that sort of San Francisco sort of attitude carried on up into Canada. But then it's a pity what happened, all that, just heroin. Suddenly it was flooded with heroin. You couldn't get a bit of grass anywhere.
What am I saying? You know, well, no, remember we were doing that. We played in the East Town Theatre, I think it was called, in Detroit, with the Allumbrus.
Yes.
And Iggy and the Stooges. We reckon Iggy couldn't play. He was jumping into the crowds. And the Allumbrus and us, we were doing the playing.
Yeah. Butch Trucks.
Yeah.
And Johnny Joy Johansson, I think his name was, the other drummer.
Yeah.
Butch And his son now was incredible guitar player. He's played with Clapton and all. Butch was a wonderful man, gave me his address and he said, anytime you're in America, come up and see us. And very humble man too as well. The way he say, I just hold it down for Johnny, I just lay the grooves down and Johnny does all the playing. Fantastic band, Dwayne Allman.
Like that was one of the great guys, like playing with those guys. And then of course we arrived in the Fillmore West.
There you go.
It was on that.
Exactly. And the two singers with the turtles over them at the time.
That's right, the Fluorescent Leech and Eddie Dwayne.
That's it.
And the first band on was Ashton Gardner and Dyke.
That's right.
They did the hit with the Resurrection Show. With
Resurrection
Show. Two fat ladies in the middle of the floor.
Yeah.
Two fat ladies in the middle of the floor. Boom, boom.
Ashton Gardner and Dyke. Yeah.
And the guy was on then, the next guy was on Boz Scaggs. And he was with the Steve Miller Band for a long time. So those three were on then. We were on first.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Your man said, great.
Your man said to me, what way do you want the monitors? I said, we don't use monitors. We were the loudest band you ever heard in the building. Like,
and the communal dressing room, them bands were just real. Everybody was in the one room. It was absolutely fantastic to meet all
these people. Frank was sitting on the sofa there.
Yeah, holding court.
Yeah, trying to think he was important, which he was.
Of course he was.
Yeah, but we were loudest. We didn't care either.
He was way ahead of the posse at that time. Too far ahead, actually.
Well.
But there you go.
The Hot Rats.
Great times.
So we've done everything now, and next thing you know, after this, that year, we went back in Dublin, none of us have any money.
That's right. I remember having the selfie gear just to get the boat fare home. Couldn't afford to fly, got the boat fare back home. Yeah, that particular time when sort of things disintegrated, it was very, very sad.
When Gary left the band,
we
found it very, we couldn't replace him, even though Paul Chapman was a great guitar player.
Superb.
We didn't live anywhere. We didn't have any money. We didn't have the energy to go. The numbers were so intricate.
Yeah.
That it was impossible to go over them again.
Of course.
Do you know what I mean? Yeah. So, and then we couldn't write anything new. And Paul done his best and he went on to play with Lone Star and UFO. A great lad. But we just, things just, there's nothing we could do now. You know, that was it. We couldn't replace Gary, and as he said himself, he couldn't replace us. He went down, he'd done the two guitar thing, then he tried it. The heavy metal thing didn't suit him at all. He was blessed, he went back in with Phil, and then he found the blues, and he went great. We came back, we done whatever we had to do to make a living.
Yeah.
Because there was no, we were fallen heroes, and then we wound up the two of us in the bag of the inn after touring the world, and 16 people
told me. Well, if you remember properly now, Brent, the first week nobody joined us,
right,
and the barman took pity on us and gave us a fiver between us.
We played with the Allman Brothers, we were over the Fillmore West.
Who are they?
Yeah.
Which is very funny because Audrey was giving one of the young lads a lesson down the shed. She plays the drums, as you know, man, and she was giving a lesson to one of the lads, and I went down to see her about something, and I just said to the young man, I says, I'm up here listening to Ginger Baker. And he says, who? I says, Ginger Baker, the Cream.
Yeah.
Who? Can you get them on YouTube? I says, God, like how things have changed.
Yeah.
Like that's what we were sort of brought up on, you know, all the blues and John Mayall, which brings us back to the Wimpy Bar in there, actually.
The Blues
Breakers.
When you found
out
the name, that's how it
was. Yeah, how the name originated.
Yeah.
And did you tell? Did you?
No, basically what happened though was, you know, we had the blues, we were all trying to think of names.
Yeah.
And we were looking at the back of the Blues Breakers and the saxophone player. His name was Alan Skidmore.
Alan Skidmore, that's right.
So we go for Skid Row, you know. Tess says, I don't think that's great, your father's moustache is better, you know, but that's how the name came around though.
I think he was outvoted on that one.
Yeah,
you know. That's how the name came about, and that's really all you're looking for with this thing here, Brent. All you're looking for is a bit of, you know, just give me the truth. All we want is the truth, as John Lennon
said. That's right, all we're saying that Bon Jovi. And if you're looking in, John, no one here is asking why you did. We like you a lot, you just have to admit that we might be just slightly better than yous were, you know. So all I'm saying is, like, get in touch, John, give us a ring, you know.
Yeah,
we'd love to hear you.
A small explanation, John. Like, you can see that photograph there. Like, we toured around with Skid Row. We hold the record for the National Stadium, which at the time was the biggest venue in Dublin. We hold the record ourselves and the Dubliners. I'm sure you've heard of the Dubliners, a great ballad group. We also filled the Ulster Hall in Belfast, which at the time was the biggest venue in Belfast. We filled that twice on the one night. So we are very, very well known over here. And I'm sure that before Bruce has finished here with this program, there's going to be thousands and thousands of people coming out saying, yeah, they were the original Skid Row. How come what happened happened? How come we sort of get lost in the wilderness? And yous take...
We've done very well out of our name now. We made no money. We're not looking for money, obviously. What we're looking for is respect. That's what it's all about.
Exactly.
That's what we're looking for. It's terrible to think that not only myself done all these things and somebody would take our name, know that we're alive, and say, we're so big, we can walk all over those guys, you know. They're over in Ireland. They won't be able to contact us. But in the last 25 years, the world has changed now.
Exactly.
We have the internet.
Now we have resources.
Yeah. We can just talk like this here today. And obviously I'm home to get a new kitchen out. And we'd like some of the comments I'm laughing about. I just have to say, the guy that says to Sebastian, if I was you, I'd do this, and then you can keep the name after that guy does. You know, like, you can't buy that sort of stuff. We love that now, don't we? We love all that. So what we're saying is, we're still out here. We're still alive. All we're asking for is a bit of respect.
That's all. Bit of recognition, bit of respect. We're not thinking of our bank balance.
No.
I never did. Like, the reason we got into this game of the horse was we weren't thinking about our bank balance. It was a love of music and a love of adventure. Like, we were able to tour around Sweden in the back of a van. We slept in the back of a van.
Yeah.
Oh, by God, having to get out at 4 o'clock in the morning. We had to run around the van to get warm. It was so cold.
Yeah, it was cold, though.
Like, and we have people that were there with us. We have Frank Murray, Ted Carroll, Paul Scully,
yeah.
And then all the great musicians that we were lucky enough to play with after.
I've mentioned all the lads. We'll be talking about Dave Boy. He's a grand lad. He's over in Luxembourg. And we're not forgetting about Donny Devon. He looked after the brass section for us and played keyboards as well.
That's right.
We got all the lads will be in to talk to us at different times. So all we're saying is, like, we love life, and we love the music, and we're still out there playing, and we're still doing something. And as Aldous said, everybody needs a little RESPECT, and we didn't get it. And we're annoyed about it. And this is not going to stop, no matter what happens, till John Bon Jovi and the boys come out and do an acknowledgement on us. We want it on all the websites now. We want it on all the heavy metal magazines.
We want
everybody to know
that
we were there, and we're still here. And we will be here.
And we're not going away.
Lovely,
I think that'll do it. That was great.
Thanks, Noel. Good news, not great.